Vacancy rates in Manila remain elevated, but experts say the enactment of the Create More bill could actually ease those levels. Andrea Taguines has the full story.
While office vacancy rates in Metro Manila are on a downtrend, real estate services firm JLL said it remained elevated during the third quarter of 2024. During a briefing on Tuesday, JLL said in the absence of new Philippine offshore gaming operators, the business process outsourcing sector as well as government agencies carried the office space market.
We have around 500,000 square meters of office space that was taken up during the nine-month period for 2024. So this represents around the 32.1% increase on a year-on-year basis from the 388,000 that we saw in the year-to-date for the third quarter of 2023.
Move-outs, however, were also significant, with 129,000 square meters of released spaces in the third quarter alone, bringing the total to 271,000 square meters in the first 9 months of the year.
This is underpinned by the rationalization of spaces by office occupiers as they continue to act on their office strategy for the short to medium term.
According to De Los Reyes, the corporate recovery and tax incentives for enterprises to maximize opportunities for reinvigorating the economy or create more bill could help address the situation. This measure was passed by the Senate on final reading in September. The bill includes a provision that requires enterprises registered under the Philippine Economic Zone Authority to have 50% of their operations back on site after having switched to remote work arrangements during the COVID-19 pandemic. If enacted, this is seen to reduce office vacancy rates by up to 70%. De Los Reyes said this would also ease some of the supply pressure that the office market will be facing over the next 3 years.
We're seeing around 1.1 million square meters of new office space over the next couple of years. And again, we know that these have low pre-commitment levels, or meaning low take-up. And once they come online, that will definitely apply supply pressure on the market.
Meanwhile, JLL is anticipating a happy Christmas for the retail market as more retailers open shop to take advantage of the holiday season spending frenzy. And for the hospitality segment, which will see an increase in tourist arrivals. Andrea Taguines, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Senate Finance Committee has recommended 164 billion pesos in adjustments to the proposed 2025 General Appropriations Act. The total budget remains unchanged, but the panel did suggest increases in some areas and reductions in others. It upheld the House's approved budget of over 10 billion pesos for President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s office, as well as the reduction of 1.3 billion pesos in the proposed budget of the Office of the Vice President, which is now left at 733 million pesos. Committee Chairman Senator Grace Poe notes, despite multiple requests, the OVP has yet to submit documents to clarify its budget. The figures are not final until the Senate votes on it. The National Economic Development Authority Board, chaired by President Marcos, has approved funding increases for two major anti-flood projects. The Cavite Industrial Area Flood Risk Management Project will see its budget more than double to 22 million pesos. Its timeline also extended from April 2024 to September 2029. As of September 30 this year, it's already 44% complete, aiming to reduce floods in parts of San Juan and Cavite. Meanwhile, the Pasig-Mabikina River Channel Improvement Project Phase 4 saw a 74% funding spike from 33 million to 57.6 million pesos. There will also be a 63-month extension for the project implementation, now running through March 2031. The project aims to mitigate flooding in Metro Manila and nearby areas. Government's flood mitigation efforts put into the spotlight after the devastation caused by recent storms Christine and Leon. In Batangas, Governor Hermilando Mandanas has blamed the Environment Department for what he calls the inaction on Pansipit River dredging, which he says is among the reasons for the massive flooding in his province. The death toll due to the storms reached 154, 59 of these recorded in Batangas alone. And we have this, Justin. The Philippine unemployment rate falls to 3.7% in September from 4% in August. That translates to about 1.89 million jobless Filipinos compared to 2.07 million in August. Meanwhile, underemployment rate is also down to 11.9%, equivalent to 5.94 million Filipinos underemployed for that period. Of course, underemployment is seen as an indicator of a quality of work because it refers to people who currently have jobs but are looking for extra work to make ends meet. Fiber internet connection in the Philippines set to get a boost with the expected completion of the next phases of the national fiber backbone next year. Jackie Pascual tells us all about the push for fiber as stakeholders move away from the legacy copper cable. Take a look.
The Philippines hosted the Fiber Connect APAC conference, where delegates from dozens of countries gathered to discuss the future of fiber internet connection. Information and Communications Technology Secretary Ivan John Uy said the Philippines is playing catch up in this field, but the country is gaining ground. He says phase 2 and 3 of the National Fiber Backbone Project will be online next year.
Biggest beneficiary are all the government agencies. Dahil lahat sila ngayon will be given broadband connectivity, especially yung mga national agencies in the provinces. But at the same time, yung mga LGUs will also be connected.
Phase 1 covers Luzon, while the next phases cover far-flung districts. The recent approval of a World Bank loan, he says, is a big help as it will speed up the expansion of fiber connection in remote areas within 2 years.
If we rely on the GAA, the General Appropriations Act, on an annual basis, aabutin tayo ng 2028 and we'd probably not reach Mindanao yet.
Conference organizers believe the Philippines can be a key player in the fiber industry because of its geographical location.
In terms of bandwidth, submarine cable coming to the Philippines, how well you're connected. So you're not only connected within the country, but you're connected globally. And that's a huge plus.
They hope there will be an expansion of fiber connection in the region over the legacy copper cable because of the increasing demand for data. A telco adds, fiber is also more sustainable.
Like they explained, there's going to be huge bandwidth requirements, data centers coming, hyperscale coming. So the type of optical fiber to be laid is going to be low latency. Low latency means you can have easily smart cities, AI kicking in.
It's much more efficient in terms of power consumption, about 71%. In terms of reliability, since you know copper heats up, the metal heats up, right? Instability of the network, it's much more resilient.
Secretary Uy hopes the National Fiber Backbone will be completed by 2026, so prices of fiber internet can possibly go down. And having faster internet can also beef up the Philippine economy. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Steel Asia Manufacturing ships over 14,200 metric tons of steel bars valued at $8.8 million to Canada. That's about half a billion pesos for its infrastructure projects. Now, early next year, it's actually set to send an additional 30,000 metric tons worth over a billion pesos to the Great White North. This latest shipment will mark Steel Asia's seventh export of rebars for Canadian infrastructure projects sourced from its Davao mill, which also supplies upcoming larger shipments. With five mills and a combined production capacity that places it among the largest rebar manufacturers in Southeast Asia, Steel Asia plans to establish new plants across the country in the coming years to reduce shipping costs and maintain competitive pricing for its customers. For context, by some estimates, over 70% of all infrastructure, housing, power, industrial developments in the Philippines use Steel Asia rebar. All right, still on the U.S. elections, let's head over to Los Angeles, where some Filipinos are now trying their luck at securing government seats. For the latest on the elections there, we have Steve Angeles joining us. Hi, Steve. Go ahead.
Hi, Michelle. It's election day in Los Angeles and throughout the region. LA has seen a steady stream of voters eager and ready to cast their ballots, and among them, many Filipino Americans ready to make their voices heard at the ballot box. Voters in Los Angeles have told us throughout the day that some of the key issues on their mind as they mark their ballots include the economy, crime, and reproductive rights. While many people have been making their voices heard ever since the early voting period began last week, there's a couple of Filipino Americans in Los Angeles looking to make history. Former Los Angeles Public Works Commissioner Jessica Coloza is looking to be the first Filipina woman to make it to the state assembly, running for the state's 52nd Assembly District, which covers parts of Northeast Los Angeles and Glendale. On a more local level, tenants' rights attorney Isabel Jurado was looking to become the first Filipino-American elected to the Los Angeles City Council as she eyes the city's 14th district, which includes downtown Los Angeles and the Filipino hub of Eagle Rock.
But we could not be more proud and grateful for the campaign that we've run. We didn't do this work alone. We did this with the support of hundreds of volunteers and people in the community.
Today is a really important day, not just for me, but for the community that's raised me. Voting is one way that we can effectuate change, and it is one of the tools in the toolkit for the communities to really have their voice heard, to make policies known, and to fight for the change that they want to see in their community.
Vote centers are open until 8 p.m. That's about 2.5 hours from now, and the tally will begin shortly after the polls close. However, it may take as long as 1 month to see and declare any winners, depending if some of the races are close. Steve Angeles, ABS-CBN News, Los Angeles.
Americans casting their ballots in the tight presidential race between Republican nominee former President Donald Trump and Democratic nominee Vice President Kamala Harris. Among the seven battleground states, Pennsylvania is considered the top prize with its 19 electoral votes. While Election Day in the states began quietly, some polling places in Philadelphia were brought to life by DJs creating a festive atmosphere. Don Tagala joins us live for more. Hi, Don. How's the situation there?
Michelle, the polls just closed in the battleground state of Pennsylvania at 8 p.m. It would have been a quiet election day in this Philadelphia neighborhood if not for the DJs at the polls, blasting their music in selected polling places, making it sound more like a dance party than election day. Election officials say more than half of the 161 million registered voters have voted in the U.S. Pennsylvania state data shows about 20% of registered voters have already cast their ballot. 1.8 million Pennsylvanians voted by mail. But some PhilAms voted in person today for the experience, like PhilAm barista Nikita Arnett Orr, who stopped by her polling place before heading to work. Chris Rivera of PhilAm Associations of Philadelphia, who also voted in person today, says the older PhilAm generation found mail-in voting more convenient for those who don't often go out of their homes due to their age. An independent voter from Washington, D.C., Eric LaChica, says he voted early so he could help get the vote out in the battleground state of Pennsylvania. For PhilAm business owner Raquel Dang, she says her voice in this election cycle is extremely important, living in a big battleground state with 19 electoral votes at stake in Pennsylvania.
Whoever wins electoral vote here in Pennsylvania is very likely going to be the next president. So I think for me, being Filipina, living in Pennsylvania, our vote matters that much more, especially knowing Filipinos are now the second largest Asian American demographic. So definitely important.
I voted this morning, election day. I think I got to the polling place at 7:05. Bright and early before my coffee. That's how serious it is. I love voting. I love feeling connected to so many other people doing the same thing. I feel optimistic, but also a little cautious.
This is Don Tagala from the battleground state of Pennsylvania. Minutes from now, we will get more updates on the latest results. So stand by for that.
All right. Thank
Michelle.
You. Thank you very much, Don Tagala, there joining us live from Pennsylvania. Now, here's a quick look at the flash business headlines from overseas. Nearly three quarters of voters in today's U.S. presidential election believe American democracy is under threat. Exit poll data from Edison Research shows 73% of voters believed democracy was in jeopardy. The economy also ranked as one of the top issues for voters, followed by abortion and immigration. As millions of Americans wait in line, both Kamala Harris and Donald Trump faced an uncertain finish after a whirlwind campaign marked by sharply differing visions for the country. Bali, Philippines, set to transport Filipinos to the magical realm of Neverland with a full-length production of Peter Pan. The show will run from December 6 to 8 at the Theater at Soler. The company promises a reimagined version of the classic tale, complete with a revamped libretto and brand new choreography, while still preserving the essence of the beloved story of the boy who never grew up.